Offshack, was a Navy brat. Moved 15 times before she was 10 years old. Every school was a fresh start. She landed in 1966 here in Santa Cruz Valley and never left. She bought her first house at the age of 18 years old. Kind of super achiever. Got into real estate at the age of 22. Was the top agent in the valley for many years. At the age of 28, she bought the office that she worked in with a partner, increased the business over 250% in 2 years. I remember that distinctly. It was in the beginning of my career that I witnessed that happen. Wendy was the youngest person in the office that she owned. From age 30, and for the next 25 years, she created a multi-million-dollar award-winning real estate and mortgage company. Her office was in the top 1% of franchise offices nationwide. The awards that she cherished most was the Per Person Productivity Award, and I know Wendy, I understand why she really cherished that. That meant that the agents in her office, on average, were the most productive than any other office in her region. She attributes that to a positive, success-oriented work atmosphere combined with structures, fun, and hard work on everyone's part. Fresh Start by Design was established in 2009 and evolved into her dream of helping people. She has since retired from real estate to do her mission, which I'm going to share with you right now. Whether it is one at a time or by the hundreds, my mission is to help people become the person they have always wanted to be. It was my distinct pleasure that I introduced you this evening with the Offshack, President and CEO of Fresh Start by Design.
I don't know about you guys, but I'm going to have an awful lot of fun tonight. You know why I say that? Because if I'm not having fun, you don't have a choice. I'm sorry, they're turning on the music. Let's get this started again.
Yeah.
day starts. And if you thought about how important it is to get out of bed on the right foot, and if you start with that, how can you possibly have a bad day? The answer is you can't. So we're going to talk a little bit tonight about all the things we're doing. As Steve said, my name is Wendy Offshack, and I am the founder of Fresh Start by Design. And I'm really happy to be here tonight, and I'd like to thank Steve for that warm, exciting welcome, and to our friend Jean Bleeker for putting this on, and to Intero for putting this all together. We really appreciate having a home for tonight. So thank you so much. That's pretty awesome. So I'm going to start with a question. You want to play tonight? Say yes.
Yes.
Okay, good. All right, we're on the right page now.
Okay.
All right. So if you played with me, that means you can participate, right?
Right.
Right. Okay, good. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you a question. And I'm going to maybe ask a couple of them. So how many of you have your life right on track, but you might like to take it up a notch a little bit? How would you like to do that? Okay. How many of you have your life that's kind of not on track, and you'd maybe like to find that track? How many of you feel like you don't have a clue, and you don't even know what a track is? How about that? Well, that was exactly who I was and where I was about 3 years ago. And we're going to talk a little bit about that tonight. The name of my course that we're teaching tonight is called It's Your Turn. And it's 7 easy steps to getting your life back in control. And what I'm going to tell you very simply is that the reason I created this course is because this is exactly what I did, because I was totally lost. I was that last third question. I had no track. So we're going to share some good times, and we're going to share some bad times, and I'm going to tell you a little bit, a little story. And I want you to know that my parents here. I have actually a lot of my family is here tonight, and my dad, John Cade, is captain in the Navy, and my mother's here, and my boyfriend and sister-in-law. Anyway, I have a lot of family and friends, and they're here to support me, and I really appreciate that very much. And my dad has been my biggest fan, both my parents have been my biggest fan since I was, you know, this high. And when I got into business a long time ago, my dad, I was kind of overwhelmed. And I was speaking and I was doing a bunch of stuff, and he gave me a book. And this book was called Don't Go Into Your Next Presentation Naked. And it's a sequel to the book that says, I See You Naked, I Can See You Naked. And it's about the speaking industry and that kind of stuff. And what happens is, your speakers, to calm themselves down, they have to pretend like your audience is naked, right? Well, I just wasn't going to go there. I'm not thinking that's the right answer. So, but what I am going to tell you is that being up here and the way I do my presentations, it's a little like being naked. And the reason I say that is because I have nothing to hide. I have had the most amazing life in the world. And I have had amazing successes, and I have crashed and burned harder than you can even imagine. And you know what? I don't regret a minute of it. Okay. Maybe a little bit. Maybe just a little bit. But it's important that you understand that I'm coming from my heart, and this is where I've been, and I'm willing to share everything with you. I have nothing to hide. I have nothing to be embarrassed about, and I really want you to really get a good handle on that, because that's what life is all about. I put myself out there. Sometimes it worked and sometimes it didn't. But we did continue to go along. So the first thing that I want to do is I want to acknowledge all of you for being here, because we've got a good full room tonight. And, you know, whenever you want to take a first step on trying to do anything or get anywhere, it is that first step. And so the best part of the first step is you have to show up. So you've all showed up tonight, and that's pretty good. So here's what I'd like you to do. Everybody raise your right hand. Way high in the air. Okay? Now I want you to very slowly go over to the right and go down behind your neighbor. And I want you to pat him on the back and say, congratulations for showing up. Congratulations for showing up. Okay, we're here. We're going to have a good time. So we have a limited amount of time tonight. But what I'm going to teach tonight is actually a full day of a three-day program. So I'm going to kind of condense it a little bit, as you can see. So, you know, Steve talked a little bit about what I did and how I grew up and some of the accomplishments I have, and I really have enjoyed my life a lot. And then, about 5 years ago, I kind of came unglued. I got unstuck, or I got stuck, or something happened. And my life wasn't working for me the way I really wanted it to work anymore. And so I needed to make some changes. And not being one that was necessarily afraid of change, because I've done it so well, I started kind of figuring out what I wanted, and I shook up my world a little bit. And in a very short period of time, within like 18 months, several things happened. I got divorced. The business that I'd had for 25 years, I ended up selling to one of my competitors. And then I went to my agents and I said to them, you know, I'm tired, I'm burnt out, I have been doing this for 25 years, and I just don't want to do this anymore, and I want to retire and go off and do something different. And they said, well, you know, we can understand that, Wendy, but no, we don't want you to do that, and we want you to just keep doing what you're doing, because we'll make it easy for you, we'll make it okay. And unfortunately, that's exactly what I did. And you know, you talk about mistakes. That was the single biggest mistake I have ever made in my entire life. And I say that with every ounce of my being. And I'll tell you why. Because how many of you understand that you live from right here? That if you're not doing what feels good right here, your entire world just kind of goes away. And if you're not living congruently. And so everything I touched for the next 18 months just turned it ugly. and it was tough. It was really tough. And one of the other things that happened at the same time was that in addition to changing and getting divorced, and then I ended up having to close my office, and then all the money that I had that I was going to retire with, I poured back into the office. That was the dumbest thing I ever did. Okay, just one of them, but anyway. And here I am, now going, okay, now what do I do? So the first question that I had to ask myself is, okay, who am I? For 25 years, I was a full-time wife. I was a full-time mother. I was a business owner. I was a homeowner. I was a dog owner, and my dog died. Both of my kids got married and moved out. And this is like in a short 18-month period of time. And all of a sudden, I'm just totally lost. I don't know who I am. And so it's all when we define ourselves by our titles. And because I had done that for so long, it was really very tough for me. So we're going to talk a little bit about how I got past that. So I'm going to put a little thing on board. Say that word? These words?
Emotional paralysis.
Who can tell me what that means? Okay.
So basically, you've got so many things going on up here that you're frozen. You can't do anything.
Right. Mm-hmm. And that is exactly it. And that's what happens when you start to get so wound by everything that's going on in your world. it's really difficult to go and do anything or go anywhere. So what happens is, the clinical definition of emotional paralysis, and I'm going to read this right from the book here. It says, and you did really good, so let's give her a hand. I'm impressed. The clinical definition says, when you become so overwhelmed with a highly emotional situation in your life, and you don't know what to do to fix it, so you do nothing at all. Okay? So now let me tell you my dad's definition. Kelly, can you put up our screen there with the alligator? When I was quite young and having issues in business, my dad said, honey, when you're up to your ass in alligators, it's really hard to remember that your main objective is to drain the swamp. Okay? And it's really very true. And I had a friend, not quite there yet. So I want to talk to you a little bit about alligators. You know, they get kind of mean, and they grow, and they grow, and there's more, and there's more, and there's more, and there's more. And when you're not dealing with your alligators, you know what happens? They don't go away. You just start to spiral. Because you now become so overwhelmed that you just continue on and on and on your way down. Until the point that you become so overwhelmed, and if you hit the bottom, that's when people start to turn to drugs or alcohol or food or any kind of other, you know, substance of use de jure. And it's a really tough thing. And so what we're going to talk about tonight is how you deal with these alligators. How you deal with getting them under control so that instead of looking mean and ugly like this, they look a little bit more like this. And he's just as cute as can be. You know, your problems will never go away, ever. But they become manageable. And that's what you have to understand. So we're going to talk about that tonight, okay, with my little alligators. I have a whole box full of tricks here. So we're gonna have a whole bunch of fun. Okay. The very first thing that we're gonna talk about tonight. Okay, can you repeat that for me, please? Now say, woohoo! Okay, so we're going to talk about that because it really is all about you. And the very first step of our seven steps is called accepting 100% responsibility for your life. Okay, so Kelly, why don't you tell us what that's really all about? Responsibility for your life. you understand that it is all about you. And there's two ways that you can take this on. And the first one is that it can be very scary. Because you know what happens when you take responsibility for your life? It is all about you. And some people just don't like that. Because who you are shows up in spades. Okay? If it is all about you, you have to really accept that everything that's going on about your life has been caused from right here. Okay? It's not your neighbor, your husband, your brother, your teacher, your anybody else. It's all right here. And you know, a lot of people say that you can't control every situation. And that's absolutely correct. But the saying that goes along with that as well is you cannot control the wind, which is a very true statement. But you can control your sails. So what that says is that's all about choices. And so we're going to talk a little bit more about that. Okay? We talk about stories, and the stories that we tell people, the stories that we tell ourselves about why things are happening to us. That's all it is a story. And sometimes we have to really dig deep and accept full responsibility for that. So the other way to look at it, which is the way that I get excited about, is it's empowering. Because when you think about the fact that it is all about you, that means you can have anything that you want. That means that you are in control. And it is all about you. And so a lot of times, you just say that all of the stops are now removed. So here's what I'd like you to do with me today. I'd like everybody to stand up. Thank you. Okay. Now the first thing that I'd like you to do is I'd like you to repeat after me, and I'd like you to say, it is all about me.
It is all about me.
And then I'd like you to say, I am in complete control of my life.
I am in complete control of my life.
And then I want you to say, I can have anything that I want.
I can have anything that I want.
Now say that three times as loud. I can have anything that I want. Exactly. Okay. Now turn to your neighbor, your right neighbor. Turn to your whoever, whatever neighbor you want to go to. Okay. Now here's what I want you to do. I want you to tap on your chest. And I want you to say to your neighbor, it is all about me. And then say, I can have anything that I want. And then I want you to say, point your finger at your neighbor this way. I know it's not polite to point, but that's okay. Point your finger at your neighbor and say, it is all about you too. And you can also have anything that you want. Okay, now give him a high five and says, isn't that amazing? Hi. Thank you.
You're amazing. Okay, you were taking over. Now you are. Okay, all
right. So when you realize that it really is all about you, and you can have anything that you want, it is absolutely empowering. And I get really excited about that. So the second one. So now that we know it is all about us, the next thing that we have to do is understand that, this is number two, the past what do you think that says? The past is not equal to the future. How many really, really grasp that? You know, as I said when I first started tonight, that on my road to success, I have scraped my knees. I mean, I've got gashes in them like this. But it didn't stop. And the thing that I like is the fact that I don't feel bad about what happened. Did I feel good while it was happening? No, not even a little bit. But I don't feel bad. because I stuck myself out there. I did my best. I did the things that I wanted to do. And sometimes it worked, just like I said before, and sometimes it didn't. But you know what? When it didn't, did I just sit there and go, I don't think so. You can't do that. You have to forgive, you have to forget, and you have to just not forget the lesson. Forgive yourself, forgive the people that are around you, but don't forget the lesson. And move on. It's really important. You know, there are so many people in life that have not done very well in the beginning. And I have, on my website, I have 50 of them listed. And you can go there someday and just read all about them. And it's Lincoln, and it's, you know, Edison, and Lucille Ball, and all those people. I'm sure you've seen some of those things come around. Well, one that I really enjoy in particular, his name was Eddie Arcaro. How many of you know who Eddie Arcaro is? There's a racing fanatic. Okay. Eddie Arcaro was the winningest jockey of all time. Okay? And he lost his first 250 races before he ever won one race. And when he lost 250 races in a row, and everybody kept saying, oh, come on, Eddie, just give it up. Do you think Eddie did that? Don't think so. Okay. Walt Disney filed bankruptcy 7 times. So let me tell you what I say about that.
For what?
So what? Do you think anybody cares that Walt Disney filed bankruptcy 7 times? I don't think so. I think what we care about is that he kept going and he did not quit. And that he succeeded beyond his wildest imagination. And that's what we have to do in order to do that. We just pick ourselves up and dust ourselves off and we start all over again. Kelly, we can do this again. I hope you like music because I sure do. So we're gonna do this again. And this is Frankie Baby. I say, I like what he did, so we're going to keep doing it. Who can tell me why you think people are afraid to fail?
They'll look bad.
Emotional paralysis.
Okay. They'll look bad. What that means is that they care too much about what other people think. And so what happens is, because they care so much, they're not willing to set themselves up, to go out and make amazing achievements because they're afraid they're going to fail, because they're afraid of what other people are going to say. And if you live your life being afraid of what other people are going to say, you will live right here in this comfort zone. You won't ever go out of it. You won't ever go, you know, you just exist. And that, personally, I want to live my life that way. I don't know about you. I think the worst thing than failing is having never failed. Because that means you never got out there. You never gave it your best shot. And so that's what I just keep doing. You know, somebody has said to me in the past, you know, gosh, Wendy, I don't know if you want to do whatever you're going to do because you might fail again. So what? Okay? I'll keep going until I get it right. And that's how I feel. Okay, so number 3 is you can't change your life until you change your mind. And we all have little voices in our heads. And I happen to have some very personal friends that talk on a regular basis. And this is my buddy Peter. And Peter is very positive. So I have, he's positive Peter, okay? And let me tell you what Peter says to me. He says, "Oh, Wendy, you're so wonderful. You can do anything. It is such a bright, sunny day outside. Just pick yourself up, go outside, have a great time. I know you can do it no matter what it is you can do. I know you'll succeed and you'll do it really well." Okay? Okay? And he's my hero. And I just love this guy. He's awesome. Okay? So, positive Peter sitting over here on this side. Who do you think is sitting over here on this side?
Negative Nelly.
Debbie Downer. Yeah. This is my other little buddy. And this I refer to as Negative Nancy. And she is a dragon spewing ugliness. And she says, "Oh, for God's sakes, why in the world do you think that you're special? You know, you should just go get a job just like everybody else does in the world." And Peter says, "But wait, no, that's not what you want to do. That's not how you want to live your life." And Nancy says, "Oh, Peter, for God's sakes, just stick a fork in her. She is so done. I don't know why in the world she would even think about trying to do anything special because she's just no better than anybody else." How many of you have these people in your head? Okay. And they talk to you on a regular basis. And what you have to do is you have to realize that one or the other will control your life. And it's based on what you say to yourself, and how you say it is how they control your life. And so what you need to do is you need to feed Peter. And you need to tame Nancy. It's the whole idea of just, you know, literally put a sock in it, okay? Because that's what you need to do. So these are my buddies, and we're going to talk for a few minutes about how we can go forward with this. So, what kind of things can you do that you can feed Peter? Who can help you with that? What kind of things?
Positive affirmations.
Positive affirmations. So you would say those like every day?
Every day.
Every day?
Write them out every day too.
Write them out, okay. How about positive books? Like this book called Mind Power by John Kehoe. One of the best books I've ever read in my entire life. Okay. So now, I have a bunch of question cards, and these are the things that I made myself while I was trying to figure out what I really wanted to do, because I've heard that if you ask the right kinds of questions, you'll start to get the right kinds of answers. And so I just put them all in here, and I just kept reading them, and reading them, and reading them, and reading them. And then I would pick up thing, and my lovely sister-in-law sent me something like this. And I love this stuff. It says, "Focus on what's right, not what's wrong." And this is the kind of stuff that feeds Peter. Is that you feed him over and over and over again, and all of a sudden, he starts to get strong, and he will support you. And so it's really easy to be able to make that happen when you continue to go forward with that. You know, I want to tell you a little story about when I was a kid. I had gotten right out of school. I went to college in Canada's out here, and I took bookkeeping and shorthand, and I went, "Ugh, I don't think I want to do that for the rest of my life." So I got into the corporate world. And I started working for a big record company. And I was 20 years old, and I was having a ball. Because I was in the sales and promotion department, and all the record artists would come through, and we'd take them around places. And I mean, I was in heaven. And I had a great boss. And then my boss got transferred to New York. And then what they did is they brought in a good old boy from Tennessee. And I sat down with him one day, and I said, "You know, I really love my job, and this is what I want to go do, and da 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 da." And he looked at me like I had three eyes, and he said, "Oh, honey, you're never going anywhere in this business." And I'm like, okay. Now, mind you, this was well over 30 years ago. And I said, but no, I mean, this is my goal. I have these dreams, and this is what I want to do. And about a week later, he took me to lunch. And he brought me a gift. And this was the gift. It was a coffee cup. And my coffee cup said, the ladder to success is much harder to climb in high heels. And he handed this to me. Today, I would be rich. I wish you could have done it today. Okay? 30 years ago, I was devastated. But let me tell you about gifts. The gift that he thought that he gave me that day was a coffee cup. That isn't the gift that he gave me. The gift that he gave me is the knowledge that somebody else had control of my destiny. And I was just full enough of piss and vinegar to go, that ain't gonna happen anymore. And I got out of the record business very quickly, and then I got into the real estate business. But that's the kind of stuff that feeds your negative Nancy's and your Peters. There's people in your entire life all the time that are trying to squash your dreams, that are trying to, you know, take you off track. And you can't let it happen. You have to keep positive. You have to keep doing the things you're doing. Because otherwise, you won't end up anywhere where you need to be. Okay? So that's just a little story about that. And that's one of the things that was really important to me. Okay, so now, number four, I actually think is the most important out of all of these. What they are is this. We have your dreams. We have goals. We have focus. And then we have intention. I hope I spelled these right. Okay. So dreams, goals, focus, and intention are all balled up into one. And Peter needs to be fed on a regular basis. And these are a focus point. One of the other ways to get him to go further in life and to help you is to be able to have something to focus on, have something to shoot for. I'm going to tell you a little story about one of my very first clients that I started coaching a little while ago. His name was Greg. And he lived in Massachusetts. And I was on the phone with him for an hour and a half, I guess. And he was a computer tech guy. And when I talked to him, he was doing some work for me. And he said, Wendy, what is it that you're doing? And I said, well, you know, I kind of help people kind of get their life back on track. And I get real excited about that. And he said, well, maybe you can help me. And I said, OK, well, tell me a little bit about you. So he said he was miserable, that he hated his job. He lived at home with his ex-wife because neither one of them could afford to move out. He didn't have enough money, he was going nowhere, and he needed something, he needed direction. So we started in kind of a little bit on this, you know, visualization type of stuff that I do. And I said, all right, great, tell me what you do for fun. And he says to me, I don't have fun. I said, okay. I said, well, Greg, if you were going to have fun, what would you do? And he says, it's been so long, I don't even remember. And he's talking to me in this monotone voice. And then I said, well, okay. So I asked him a couple more questions, and then I kind of did an end run. And I said, all right, Greg, tell me, if you can remember back when you used to have fun, what did you do? And he just kind of in conversation, he threw out the fact that he was a radio producer for his college radio station. And when he said that, he just kind of perked up a little bit in his voice. And I said, okay. So, and you really like that? And he said, yeah. And I said, well, why didn't you keep on doing it? And he said, because there's no money. And I said, Okay. Are there people in this business that are making money? Yes. Okay. So, Greg, if you were in this business and you were making money at it, where would you do this? And he says to me, I'd do it in Spain. Okay? I'm thinking maybe New York, okay? He tells me he wants to do it in Spain. And I said, okay, well, that works. And I said, why Spain? And he said, there's a whole group of people over there that do something about producing something or other. And I don't know exactly what it was. And he started talking to me. I said, have you been there? And he said, no, but I look at it on Google all the time. Okay, fine. So when he's telling me about this a little bit, he kind of gets excited. I mean, his whole tone of voice was like down here. And then he's like telling me this. And I said, well, tell me where you would live. And he said, I would live on this high hill up there. And I said, well, tell me about your house. We're kind of visualizing. And he said, okay, well, when you walk up to my doors, I have these big wrought iron gates, and it kind of goes onto this patio, and then we go into the front doors, and these big this, and we go in here, and I said, okay, fine, this is cool. This is the man that can't even have fun, and doesn't know anything. And then I said, okay, great. When you go inside, what do you see? He says, well, off to my left, I see my big living room. And I said, so what's in there? And he said, there's a bunch of people standing around having fun and talking and laughing about producing what we're doing, and they're very happy and they're very successful. I said, awesome. And I said, okay, well, let's go a little further. If you were to walk through that next room, what would you see then? And he said, I see big picture windows. I said, okay, well, walk to the window and tell me what you see out of the window. And he said, I see the ocean. I said, all right. So, you know, I've touched on a lot of his senses to help him kind of get a big picture of this. So then I said to him, all right, Greg, I want you to go open the window and tell me what you smell. Now, I'm thinking he's going to say to me, I smell the ocean, okay? And that's not what he said to me. Just hit stop. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, okay, I'm done. Never mind. Yeah, exactly. So what he did is when he opened his window and he said to me, I smell the honeysuckle growing on the vine underneath the window. I'm thinking he's going to tell me that he's smelling the ocean. And he tells me he's smelling the honeysuckle on the vine in a place that he's never been. And that's called visualization. And then he stopped me. And he went back to his monotone. I mean, the whole time he was telling me all about this, he was so excited, he just couldn't stand it. And then he stops, and he says, Wendy, can I give you a little bit of feedback? And I said, sure. And I'm thinking, oh, here it comes, okay. And he said, you know what, my whole life, people have been telling me that I can do anything or have anything that I want. But this is the first time in my life that anyone has ever showed me what's possible. And so all of these things up here are the things that you need to have to be able to focus on to be able to go forward in your life. And Greg is in the process, when he figured out that that's really what he wanted to do, all of a sudden his work isn't so bad because now he's working harder, he's making more money, because you know what he's going to do? He's going to Spain. And he has it out here. It's kind of like that proverbial carrot. So when you set your goals and your dreams, you have carrots to be able to work with. And that's what it's really all about. Okay. Now, are goals and dreams enough? No. Say no. No. The next number, next five, is action. You have to take action. Because if you just dream about dreaming about dreaming, nothing ever happens. So what you have to do is you have to put a plan together. And you have to do the kinds of things that you do in order to make that work. So I'm going to pass out some sheets here. Yeah, would you do that for me? Thank you. I'll just give them all to you. You can kind of do this. And I need another volunteer. Yeah. I was going to do this. What I'm handing out to you are what we call our daily action sheets and steps. And what this does, I'm just going to give you some and let you kind of pass them back. This is just one of the ways that you can actually start to get a handle on where you're trying to go and what you're trying to accomplish. And when you put those things in writing, it's pretty easy to keep focused on where you're going. So after you now take action and you're able to put these together and you have something to think about and you have a dream set out there, life starts to pick up all of a sudden all over again. Once you do that and you set some goals and you know where you're going and you know what you want to try and accomplish, the next one is number 6, and it is you have to do whatever it takes to make it happen. For months upon months upon months, I was just fumbling around, not having a clue what I wanted to do. I wasn't going to sell real estate anymore. I'd done that for 35 years. Now what's next? You know, I actually tried to go to work for somebody. I just want you all to know that I am 100% unemployable, okay? It just doesn't work, not even a little bit. And that was just kind of silly. And that was Nancy going, oh, just go get a job. And Peter says, are you kidding? So when you're doing this, you just have to keep doing it and doing it and doing it and doing it. And you never
give up.
Quit. Until you figure it out. You know, one of the hardest things that I had to go through during this whole time was I had to watch my family watch me just self-destruct. And out of everything that I did, that was the hardest thing for me. Because I knew that I would be fine. Because I've done it before, and I'll do it again. And I can always work my way back. But while I'm self-destructing and don't know what I'm doing and where I'm going, and I'm really having a hard time, my poor parents and my family and my daughters and my son, and everybody's like going, oh, poor mom. And that was hard for me. That was really, really, really hard for me. You know, the quality of your life is based on what you make non-negotiable.
What happened to 6?
It was do whatever it takes. Okay?
It was take it on these notes.
Right? So, you know, I knew I needed to figure out what I needed to do. And that feeling of doing what I'm doing right now, because I went through that entire struggle of putting it together and asking myself the right questions and just going on, going on, going on, and never giving up. And I then became exposed to a whole bunch of stuff in classrooms that I did. And it was only through that classroom environment that I actually took a course called Train the Trainer. And I got on stage in front of 600 people, and I loved it. And I was so excited, I went, I know what I'm going to do now. This is really cool. And so now I'm here, and I'm having a great time. So you have to decide. So the question you have to ask yourself is, if you need to make changes in your life, when are you going to do it? If you look at your life today, and you say, well, I probably should do it sometime, a year from now, is it going to be any different? Possibly not. You need to set some goals. You cannot just think about it, you've got to ink it. I'm going to show you a little book that I created for myself while I was going through this. And this is the book that I looked at every single morning while I was having breakfast. And it's got everything in it. It has my mission statements, it's got my whole ideas about things, and I've got all the questions that I ask myself on a regular basis. And then I had sayings that really were important to me and all the things that I do. And back here I have a full set of assessments that I put together for myself so I could really figure out what I wanted and where I was. And I looked at this every single day. And this is part of what I do through my coaching. So you have to ask yourself, is this what you want? You know, I like to think of myself, my business card says that I'm a motivational speaker. Well, I like to think of myself as kind of an irritational speaker. And the reason I do that, because my job is to make you uncomfortable. My job is to make you squirm in your seat a little bit, knowing that there's something more out there. And all you have to do is plug into it, and you can make it happen. Okay? My job is to make you see what's possible. Because so many of us get so caught up in day-to-day life that we're just totally overwhelmed. And it's very, very scary. And so year after year, things happen. And basically what happens is nothing happens. So that's my goal, is to help you do that. Now, what I talk about is the fact that I am coaching. And in the beginning, I think I said something about the fact that I would, you know, talk to you if you wanted to do some more. And for anybody that is interested in, you know, working one-on-one or doing some classroom coaching or whatnot, I have some paperwork that we can talk about afterwards. So, and I will stick around. So if anybody has any questions, I'm just going to say thank you so much for tonight. I hope you got something out of it, because I know I sure enjoyed it. And I have a couple of gifts for you tonight. And the first one is, I told you that I went to a series of classes. And it was called the Millionaire Mind Intensive. And it's a series of classes put on by Peak Potentials Company by Carbecker. And that one single class set me on a path to do what I'm doing. And there's a class for 3 days coming up in February on the 17th. And it's a $795 class. And I have free tickets for whoever would like to go. And it's amazing. It really, truly, truly is amazing. So that's my gift to you for coming tonight. And I just want to say thank you very much. You guys have a good night. Before I just step away, does anybody have any questions? Go ahead, Hal. Okay.
Why the butterfly?
Why the butterfly?
They're free.
A long time ago, I heard a story on the internet, and it really is what I'm all about. And a butterfly is metamorphosis? Is that what it is? Okay. They go from a little wormy caterpillar into this butterfly. And many, many years ago, I read something on the internet, and it was a story about a butterfly, and he was in his cocoon, and he was working on trying to get out, and there was a gentleman that was watching him. And he was watching him for like hours, where this butterfly is trying to get out of his cocoon and struggle and struggle and struggle and struggle and struggle. And he wasn't coming out, so the man went and got a pair of scissors, or a knife or something, and he just put a little slit in the cocoon so he could help the butterfly come out. Well, within moments, the butterfly now came out of his cocoon, but he was all withered and couldn't get around. And he could never fly, and he just wandered around, and very shortly he died. And the story of that is so poignant, because the butterfly needs that struggle. You have to have a struggle. You have to understand that you cannot get anywhere in life unless you put yourself out there and have that struggle. And that was such an amazing story for me. Because sometimes you think, oh my God, what am I doing? But you need that struggle to go forward. The butterfly didn't grow properly because part of getting out of that cocoon was the struggle. And it gets the blood flowing into the butterfly. And because he didn't have that struggle, he didn't have the proper growth, and he didn't have the proper blood flow and everything else, so he just died. He just withered and died. And that's why I chose the butterfly, because it is all about metamorphosis and what we come between ourselves. So that's why. Thank you so much.
Wendy?
Okay.
I don't have a question, but a quick statement about the last item that Wendy talked about was the millionaire mind intensive. Mm-hmm. I've done it. It is powerful. If you haven't done it, get a ticket and go. Take the time and go. It's pretty intensive, and I would recommend it to anyone and everyone in this room and anywhere else.
Yeah.
I did it 3 years ago. Well worth it.
You know,
a lot of your time. I mean, they are intensive.
They are.
Yeah. Well worth it.
And I took the Quantum Leap series after I did the MMI. Mm-hmm. And I spent my entire last year in class, asked my boyfriend, like, where are you going this week? But it was the single best education. You spend hundreds of thousands of dollars through colleges and all this other kind of good stuff. And I had a lifetime worth of lessons in this last year, and it just changed me. It just made me a totally different person. The experiences were just unbelievable. So I have a gift for you, and if you guys would like to do it, I'm going to put these on the back table back there, and you're more than welcome. It tells you exactly where to go online and what to say and the codes you have to put in to get it there, but it's coming up very soon, and I thought you'd really enjoy it. So it's pretty exciting.
Where's it?
It's down in L.A. at the, I'm thinking it's the LAX Westin, right there on Century. Yeah, Century Boulevard. So, but it's amazing. It's an amazing class.
Sleeping tomorrow.
Well, I did, yeah. Yeah. Right, exactly. Okay. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Absolutely.